at least five others.
On Valentine's Day, there was a horrible fire.
To find out it was in the tunnel was kind of shocking.
A truck had jackknifed. Traffic started backing up behind it into the tunnel.
I seen the emergency vehicles coming this way.
And now some of those cars in the tunnel had crashed into each other.
And caught fire.
Then I started getting the phone calls.
Peter Stinchcomb of the Wyoming Department of Transportation knew they had a big problem on their hands.
Yeah, Highway Patrol immediately shut it down. You know, all the cars that did make it up here, they had to find a way to turn them around and get them back.
And then shut and locked the snow gates and made everybody get off the freeway. The interstate highway from New York to San Francisco was now closed.
It's very important, not just to the community, but to commerce for the United States.
So just how ruined is the tunnel, and what's it going to take to safely get it back open?
Today, the Wyoming Department of Transportation are taking you and me on an exclusive tour inside the tunnel. The first time for the news or anybody online.
This is the story of America's smallest state by population racing against the clock to reopen America's second longest interstate highway.
Yeah, while both tunnels were shut down and no traffic was allowed up there, all of Interstate 80 was on this road.
You wouldn't think 1,100 feet of freeway would make all that much difference. And I suppose 70 years ago, it didn't. Back then, there was no tunnel, there was no freeway. Just the old Main Street, which they now call Flaming Gorge Way.
And this little two-lane road back in the 1950s was the main highway east to west through Wyoming.
So with the fire closing the tunnels, good old Flaming Gorge Way had to step up and go back to doing the old job that long ago it had retired from.
In a moment, send them all down this two-lane road.
And Green River could just barely handle the traffic right up to the point that this light would turn red.
The Detour Route's one and only stoplight.
All that traffic coming here, and then it has to stop once in a while, even a fraction or a few seconds, it starts to back it up very fast.
He tells me when this light would turn red, it would back up not just from here to the freeway.
Sometimes all the way to the other town.
Into Rock Springs, Wyoming.
Sometimes an hour drive to go, you know, 13 to 15 miles.
Leave the problem solving up to me, and I'd say, well, turn the stoplight off. Just have it blink yellow for the cars going through here and make everybody here treat it like a stop sign. But there's a big problem why that won't work.
Most of the people in town use this stoplight every single day.
One of the challenges is that Green River is split in half by the Green River.
The second biggest river in the state of Wyoming.
Which if you're from back east, you're probably ready to make fun, but for those of us out west, this is a pretty big deal.
Union Pacific's railroad tracks also splits the town.
So there's only two ways to get from one side of town to the other, and the main one is this big overpass here that loops around and comes out right at that stoplight, which means they can't turn it off.
Even during an emergency detour like this one.
Since drivers have to be able to make a left turn here, they kept the traffic signal on. They just biased it like 90% green.
That way all the through detouring traffic could keep moving 90% of the time.
Now we got all the traffic going through here. We had to figure out a plan to get that back up there to where it could continuously flow all day, every day.
Peter tells me Flaming Gorge Way was taking a beating.
I don't know what shape this concrete was in before, but throwing 15,000 trucks a day at it for, you know, 6 days, probably didn't help.
Thankfully, back up on the freeway, there was a little bit of good news.
The other tunnel survived the fire just fine, so they can squish everybody eastbound and westbound into the one tunnel.
The tunnels offer two lanes in each direction, but with just one tunnel, that now means one lane in each direction since we only have one tunnel. So how does Wyoming separate that space? Now, you could just stripe a double yellow line, but on a freeway, that's not really that safe.
Could have just put orange highway traffic cones in there to kind of separate things, but then if you do have kind of accident or something that causes a car to leave one side or the other, while one is out of service, we don't want the other one to have an incident as well.
For Peter, a concrete barrier was the only option.
I started calling a lot of the local contractors that I knew had this kind of barrier. How quickly could they get in here? How fast could they get it set up? We went with one that is here in the county, mainly because he could start the next morning.
On top of the barriers, they mounted these flags to block out headlights.
A guy like me that's in a car, those lights are shining right into my face.
And the last thing they want is me getting in a bad crash here because I couldn't see because I got blinded by a semi-truck.
Getting the westbound traffic over to the eastbound side, well, there's another stroke of good luck. Wyoming routinely paves parts of the median, these asphalt crossovers, to move cars back and forth when they're trying to do pavement projects. And there just happens to be one on each side of the tunnel.
You just gently transition. Well, my car's beeping at me, doesn't like that, but you gently transition over to the other side.
And then we have our two lanes back and we resume as if nothing happened.
All of this helped the state of Wyoming rapidly reopen I-80, even if it was just at half capacity.
You know, within a week we had everything kind of ready to go to get traffic back up here on I-80.
To squish everybody down to one lane to get through the tunnel, the right lane starts going away. And people in Wyoming have a tendency to start getting over too early. That makes a big long line, and then people get angry.
And drivers start going a little crazy.
So to make everything merge more smoothly, YDOT wants people to do the zipper merge.
There's no need for it a lot of the times in this state because we're so rural.
So Peter tells me they've been ordering signs to educate people to know.
Well, we saw it in the first few days, the long line forming. We also put some signs out on the highway that says, you know, stay in your lane until the point.
And I see this sign right here telling me it's time to merge.
They also got the word out to papers and social media. And combining all of these temporary elements together, I-80's working okay for now.
So now they're focused on the permanent fix. What's it going to take to fix the tunnel for good?
And you got to start with first finding out how bad a shape is the tunnel in right now.
We haven't had a lot of access until these guys could get vehicles that had burnt up out of there.
The fire burned over 1,500 degrees Fahrenheit. Humans couldn't even get inside for days. Wyoming Highway Patrol flew this drone through just to get some idea of what was going on in there.
You know, kind of figure out if we could even get in there without, you know, having the full Tyvek suit and respirators. You don't know what you're inhaling in there.
We learned from the wildfires in California, the dust after a big fire can have a lot of junk in it.
So a trained safety technician swabbed the wall with a special kind of alcohol wipe and rushed it off to a lab for testing.
To make sure that whatever that is, you don't want to breathe it anyway, but at least it doesn't have asbestos in it and toxic stuff.
Not an unreasonable concern, considering the tunnel was built back in the 1960s.
We weren't sure whether or not how dangerous it would be to go in.
And thankfully, the lab results gave an okay, which meant finally the Wyoming Department of Transportation got a look inside. This video is not sponsored by Fumble. Find attractive singles, swipe left, swipe right. It doesn't really matter because both of them send your profile straight to her spam folder. Which is fine, I guess. After an okay from a safety testing company, Wyoming Department of Transportation got to go inside the burned-out tunnel.
It wasn't horrible. We still had to wear masks for a little while to go in.
But it was full of burnt-out debris. So they hired this environmental services company to haul off all the toxic garbage, which there certainly was plenty, in sealed trash containers, all the way to a special landfill, hauling away all the burned vehicles and doing some power washing of the walls. They actually suck all the dirty water into this truck and haul it away to another state. Sounded like a pretty cool process, so I reached out to the company, but they haven't replied. The town of Green River is pretty darn proud of this tunnel, especially after it made a cameo in the music video for Journey's Faithfully. It was cut through solid rock back in the 1960s.
Blast out a chunk with dynamite, you know, clear that out.
And as crews burrowed their way through the hillside, installed these big semicircle ribs.
So those are the actual structural part that's keeping this in its shape.
Outside of the ribs is this decorative 15-inch liner made out of concrete and rebar. And it took the brunt of the fire.
So this is not from the fire, it's just routine wear and tear from the weather. But you see that piece of metal there? That's the rebar they're concerned about. It's all through the tunnel, and if these melt, bad things happen.
And when temperatures get over 1,000 degrees, even inflammable concrete starts to fall apart.
That's what the inspectors have been looking at. They're trying to figure out how deep that stuff goes.
As we first enter the tunnel, the walls are coated in black soot from the smoke.
See how it kind of comes up like in this area and goes up the wall.
But as we get to the middle of the tunnel, the fire burned so hot, there's no soot left.
Right here is where the main burn was, I think, and that just kind of melted all that stuff. And we can probably tell that there was a hot fire in this area due to the fact that the concrete broke up, you know, 3-4 inches.
When you build something new, construction crews mix all the materials together and create a chemical reaction that forms concrete. But buried between these molecules, extra bits of hydration, H2O. And when that molecule gets 1,500 degrees hot, it really wants to escape.
The water looks for places to go. When it can't go anywhere, it almost explodes. explodes.
And that makes chunks of concrete violently flake off the walls.
You don't really see water in there, but it is hydrated. I mean, it does have hydration in it. So.
Between melted rebar and flaking concrete, the question for inspectors is, how much of this liner needs to be replaced?
Are we going to have to go all 15 inches to replace the whole thing, or remove a lot of the unsound concrete and replace that?
So inspectors got out rock hammers and started tapping on the walls.
They're trying to figure out by the sound and whatnot how deep that's going back. Hit it with this bar.
Engineers call this sounding.
It almost sounds hollow.
And that, this helps test places where the damage is a little bit more sneaky. Other places, the concrete's almost entirely gone.
There's another good chunk of exposed rebar. Trying to get answered is this rebar still good, or do we need to remove it and replace it?
So they tapped everywhere.
That's good sounding. This is not so good.
And the inspectors filled up pages of notebooks.
Taking a lot of photos so they can continue to examine it back at the office.
This tunnel's only 1,100 feet long, so there's no ventilation systems, but it did have lighting. It's all melted now.
The concrete on the ceiling is becoming, you know, not sound, and the anchors and whatnot are starting to fall out just due to the weight of the lighting itself.
So this was all the lighting that was at the top of the tunnel. It used to be kind of a nice light beige color, but the fire made it a nice smoky brown.
So right here, this is the old pavement right here, this flat spot here.
The unanswered mystery.
But something built up on it.
What burned up inside the trucks? We know one was carrying luncheon meat. The entry to the tunnel smells like ham. But as for the rest of the vehicles...
So we've got like an inch layer of a conglomerate of melted material. Whatever it was, whether it was from the ceiling or if it was from a truck that was sitting here, or there's tires. Or
a mystery we may never know.
So the fire was almost exactly in the middle.
Yeah.
As we walked toward the exit, where the temperature was a mere 500 degrees Fahrenheit.
And here you can tell that the fire got less hot by that arc on the wall again.
But still hot enough to melt the seals between tunnel sections.
Start seeing actually black.
Where the black smoke.
But even here, where the temperature was cooler.
But I show you here, because we're clear at the end of the tunnel, 600 feet away from where we all believe the fire was at, but yet it still got hot enough here to delaminate this concrete as well.
Wyoming routinely inspects this tunnel so they can compare those reports with what they're seeing now.
They have drawn like a lot of the cracks that were previously here, so before the accident. So that was something else that they were comparing to during their inspections is, we knew that crack was there. Are there 20 others or new ones or something like that? So we do a yearly inspection, and I think last year's it was in good condition. None of those, you know, there might have been like one or two minor cracks here. According to the reports, are brand new.
If you're gonna replace the bad concrete, you wanna make sure you replace all the bad
concrete. Sounds solid. Now it doesn't.
But now comes the more expensive question. Those big steel ribs themselves, are any of them damaged from the fire? Hard to check when it's all hiding behind that 15-inch concrete liner. So the Wyoming Department of Transportation sent out this survey crew, who brought along a LIDAR machine, which gets its coordinate system, you know, X, Y, and Z, from these big white balls that they're setting up here. They're called scan targets. And then with a camera on one side and a laser on the other, the machine spins around and gets a detailed three-dimensional, well, it's not an image, but a digital object of everything within sight, stored as a file inside this terrestrial LIDAR scanner. Not to be confused with an aerial LIDAR scanner or a mobile LIDAR scanner. Over a couple of days, they'll move this thing 10 times, scanning every 100 feet or so until they've scanned the entire tunnel. And from there, investigators can check to make sure the tunnel isn't sagging. Peter tells me that now the inspections are done, and they show the middle part of the tunnel where the fire was the hottest. 500 feet of liner has to be totally replaced, as well as the roadway below.
But the good news is those curved I-beams, they're in pretty good shape, so they're not going to have to mess with those.
Wyoming will also install new lighting and clean up and restripe the highway pavement.
So if this 2,900-mile interstate from New York to San Francisco, this little 1,100-foot disruption, will soon be fixed. From Green River, Wyoming, I'll see you next time.
YouTube ad revenue alone, and I'd be standing in front of a green screen talking about this, but thanks to people like you at patreon.com/roadguyrob, I'm able to take you to the tunnel. And that's just a lot more fun. So let's give a big round of applause to the 730 people who made this story happen. You guys are the best.